Rugby World Cup warm-up matches, folks. This weekend, Wales hosting South Africa. Games that are traditionally pretty close, but two teams in kind of very different positions right now. We're going to go through the squads, some stats, predictions, recent history, and you guys can let us know your thoughts on how this one may begin to go. I say close results recently, despite the fact that the last five games goes 4-1 in South Africa, so ever so pretty heavily dominant to the box. But that one win the Welsh did have was down in South Africa on last year's tour. But mainly, of these last five games, they're almost all, barring the last one, within 7 points. Like the last one was 30 points to 14. So a bit of a blowout. But prior to that, it's a 1-pointer, 13-12. Then there's 32-29, 23-18, 19-16. A lot of close games between the Welsh and the South Africans in recent times, if you're looking back as far as 2019 as kind of recent. Although the result, to be honest, in the scheme of things, is not the main thing. The main thing for this one is to get through the match, increase your kind of prep for the World Cup and try not to suffer any injuries, get those combinations cooking. And I said the two teams in different positions. I mean, Wales 10th in the world. And kind of under new management, under Gats this year, having to go through a lot of changes and then with a bunch of guys, you know, retiring and whatnot. It's the very different position from what we see with a largely stable Springboks squad who've, kept that core from 2019 through to this World Cup with the addition of kind of a few, you know, young talents who've emerged in that four-year period. For Wales, they've kind of reverted back to the team that played a couple of weeks ago at home. Domachowski, Asarati, the two debutant props from that last game, are back alongside Elliot D. I mean, there's no bigger test really than the Springboks. So if these guys are going to get a kind of trial by fire in their second game for the two props at international level, up against the likes of a Frans Malherber and Steven Kitsoff, well, you will, I guess, very quickly learn just how things are looking on the propping front. Ben Carter, Will Rollins, it's a new second row as well. Gats is still finalising what his team's going to look like. So he's at the moment seemingly kind of got two separate squads, although there are a few guys who are kind of intermingled. Dan Lydia is one of the guys who retains his position in the back row from last week, but Jack Morgan is back. If you watch that first game they played against England, Jack Morgan was pretty much unplayable in that game. He was busting tackles, making tackles, setting up tries, and he was captain leading from the front. So he was in unbelievable form for a guy heading into World Cup. So he'll be looking to kind of replicate even half of that form, and he'll still be having a cracking game. Aaron Wainwright is there at number 8. Kieran Hardy gets a start at number 9 alongside Dan Bigger. Remember, Dan Bigger has been on the bench for the last two games, so they're kind of bringing in some of the experience for the Springboks game. And then midfield of Johnny Williams and Mason Grady. That's an all-change midfield from last week as well. They've brought in some experience with Alex Cuthbert on the wing. He's a pretty big dude, but he's up against a pretty hot-stepping Cheslin Colby, so he'll need to be defensively sound, and maybe they can chuck him some aerial ball, but Colby, despite his lack of height, is pretty decent in the air, so that'll be an interesting one to watch. And then Rio Dyer, the gas man on the other wing, with Liam Williams at fullback, who genuinely looked, you know, pretty safe under the high balls and dangerous on the counter-attack last week as well. Bench-wise, Sam Perry retains his spot, Nicky Smith and Henry Thomas, a couple of more veteran guys in terms of your propping stocks in case things go a little bit haywire there. Teddy Williams will get his debut when he comes on, so congrats to him. Tane Basham is a surprise entry on the bench. Cover a loose forward. Apparently he didn't get a concussion. He passed all his HIA stuff, so that's a bit of a good news story after him copping that Owen Farrell shoulder to the head. Thomas Williams drops to the bench. Max Llewellyn is there, and then Kai Evans will also get his debut from the bench, so another big old congratulations. For the Springboks, your fourth side in the world, I think they can go up, actually, if they take some points off the Welsh from memory. But, they've also made a few changes from the squad, which played in Argentina a couple of weeks ago. And front row-wise, man, Kitsoff, Marks, and Malherber, that's chunky. That's probably, I think, the Springboks' premier starting front row. I mean, they kind of swap Bongi and Malcolm from time to time, but they both get more tries. I mean, Marks is probably a little bit more of your kind of breakdown dominant guy. I think they like to use Bongi with those big blockbusting carries, but either way, that's a mean looking front row. Jean Klein continues on in the second row. taking Eben Etzebeth's jersey for another week. Eben has not surrendered it much, if you've seen the Springboks depth chart video, but Klein has had a wee bit of game time there in recent weeks. And then Achia Snyman gets a start. He's been on the bench for a few games, but obviously they are backing him to start. Please let that guy stay fit, because they've kind of eased him into it so slowly. It's just a little bit more, not worrying, but you know what I mean? You're just worried something's going to happen if he's going to start. But nah, he's been really good thus far, so fingers crossed for him. And then the return of Steele Kolisi is a great bit of news. His battle up against Jack Morgan will be a fascinating one, because Sia's going to have a fair bit of pent-up energy after not playing for a long time. Big injury layoff for him. He may not go past 40 that much in terms of minutes, because they've got Funstaden on the bench, so I wouldn't be surprised to see Kolisi kind of ease back into things as well. But great to see him back right on the eve of the World Cup. Peter Septu-Toi's in there alongside him, alongside Jasper Visa. So Visa keeps a hold of the 8 jersey. Jaden Hendrickson is also another guy to have back, so that's a bit of good news again on the edge of a World Cup, especially when you've got a squad with 4 halfbacks in it. So not much time for him to show that he's in sharp form. And then Marnie Lubbock, has there ever been kind of more pressure on one guy at the moment? Unless Pollard can get himself back fit. Like, Marnie Lubbock has a lot of weight on his shoulders, but good to get this game done now. He had a taste of it at the end of last year. He's had a few games this year. If he can build into it, I think he can step up to the challenge. And then Dale Ender and Creel, that's your midfield. Remember, no look on your arm, he's injured. And then Dale Ender comes in for Esther Hazen. Kanan Moody has been one of those kind of revelation players that I mentioned, who has managed to push his way into a Springbok squad over this last World Cup cycle. He's been in phenomenal form. And then Cheslin Colby's on the other wing. Like I mentioned, him up against Cuthbert is a difference in styles, that's for sure. But yeah, the Box have actually been unleashing the wingers this year, which has been very, very pleasing to see. It's one thing my dad has been wanting to see for a long time, and he's getting his wish. And then Philly LaRue will marshal the troops at the back. He comes in for Willemser at fullback. Willemser is on the bench alongside Grant Williams. So happy to see Grant Williams there. Another guy like Basham, who took a bit of a knock to the head in recent times. Bongi Mbonambi is there on the bench alongside Oxenche and Vincent Cox. So Ox is another one to have back in prep for the World Cup, which is good news. Mostert drops to the bench for the starting there, like I mentioned, and for Mulan there as well. Stats-wise, now a bit of good news for Wales is, attack-wise, they're actually looking sharper than they were last year. Like, last year, they were getting 14 defenders beaten the game. This year, 16, so it's a wee bit of an increase. They're getting 4.5 clean breaks a game compared to last year's 3. So just those little bit sharper areas, although they are conceding more clean breaks, so it kind of, like, you get a little bit more attack, a little bit conceded defense, but still not resulting in a heap of tries just yet. The tries scored count is still pretty low for Wales this year. Although in the last 2 games against England, they scored 4 and conceded 1. But part of that, I think, also goes to the fact that England hasn't been a side scoring many tries either. And Wales have been putting a fair bit of boot to ball, more so than South Africa. South Africa's got an older pack, but it's also a bit heavier. And they've been pretty apt at scoring more tries, not just throughout their history, but also this year. I think the first 3 games they played this year, the Rugby Championships games, they managed them all try every game. Last game in Argentina, it was the kind of the backs that got the glory, but you've got to be looking out for it. I mean, Wales conceded a maul try against 12 guys last week, so 12-man England, Otojo went over. So, yeah, look for the Springboks to perhaps target that area. Springboks' tackling percentage has been a little bit lower than last year. It's like 82% this year. It was 85% last year, and 82% is certainly on the low side. Like, I know sometimes guys like Fafta Klerk shoot up the line more trying to disrupt than actually make a tackle, but still, comparing like for like, they're a bit lower than last year, and the goal kicking is also at like 60%, just over. So that's an area that they need to try and get right, but like I mentioned, a great one for Libok to kind of get used to, and for Wales, maybe that's why they've brought Bigger back in, because he is a kind of secure guy generally in that area. The Box line-out's been looking improved. Wales struggled in that area last week, but Wales have overall been not too bad. And it's weird that both teams like to score most of their points in the third quarter. I think the Springboks this season are like 36-3 in that kind of first 20 minutes of the second half. So they've been piling on the points, but that is also Wales' most prolific quarter if you're breaking it down by that. I don't know why I like to do that, but I like to look at where the teams score their points. Like I mentioned, the recent history, it's pretty lopsided but close, so kind of a little weird one in itself. But how do the predictions go? Interestingly, despite the fact that Wales are at home, it is being played at Cardiff. The Box are pretty, I don't want to say comfortable favourites, but 8 points with the bookies. and 7 points with the rugby forecast algorithm. So Wales not really predicted to be a score away from victory at the end, if you know what I mean. It is on in Cardiff, like I mentioned. It is a 3:15 local kickoff time, which makes it 2:15 in the morning for those of us here in New Zealand, which is around about the worst time you can have a rugby game. But obviously, I am not the target audience here. It's for you Welsh and South African fans to enjoy. Andrew Brace from Ireland is the ref. Remember, if you like your old Super Brew, we've got a World Cup Super Brew pool. I'll put a link down in the description for your old predictions. That's always a bit of fun. But yeah, you guys let us know your thoughts. Rank 4 against rank 10. Wales hosting South Africa. Do you think this one's going to be another classic kind of arm wrestle match between these sides? Or can you see the scoreline blowing out? You guys let us know your thoughts. And yeah, I'll talk to you guys again soon. See you later.